I've been making my living selling my porcelain artwork for about 36 years now. It's changed a lot throughout the years, evolved, but this is what the work looks like now. Basically, you're looking at porcelain, wheel thrown, and that has been altered by hand, then carved away by hand, and high fire to cone 10, which is 2,350 degrees Fahrenheit. And at that temperature, the porcelain vitrifies, that is, it changes molecularly and becomes non-porous and translucent and very hard. I'm looking at light and shadow in my work and trying to make beautiful forms. Here's a little bit about how I make the work. I start on the potter's wheel to get the initial shape that I'm going to throw. When I'm happy with the form, then off the wheel, I alter that form to create volume and also structural strength, like a corrugated roof is stronger than a flat roof. Now I let the piece get halfway between wet and dry, and at that point I can carve away patterns in the piece. You see here I'm footing the piece first, get a nice bottom on the piece. Then I set into carving away the piece. I'm using here an X-Acto blade, as you can see. I have a short window of time to carve this work in, so I'm just pulling away the pieces here. And when I get the piece completely carved, then I let it get completely dry. And then I start sanding the piece and getting all of the smooth curves into that piece. When I'm happy with that piece and it's all completely done, it's ready to be fired. And at that point, I am setting this piece up to be high fired in the kiln. Now porcelain becomes soft again in its high fire state in vitrification. This piece is going to slump. This is the piece before it goes into the kiln. This is what it looks like after it's been fired and cooled down. This is, you can see the piece is slumped all the way down to the bottom of my kiln shelf. Stood back upright, here's the piece. You can see the difference of the piece, design of the same piece before it was fired and after it was fired. This directional firing that I'm using is important in all my work. Here are a whole group of pieces that are before the firing, after the firing. Some are fired right side up, others upside down, and you can see the difference in that firing process. Translucency is important in the piece, and a sense of movement. And some of the pieces I gild. I put 23 karat gold leaf on the inside. I'm creating another light source sort of in the piece. Like in a cathedral dome, a few candles can light up a whole gilded room. I want to have a light source in my work. So this is what my work looks like now, after about 36 years into my career. It didn't always look like this. It started looking more like this. This is what the work looked like when I first started selling it. But I'd really like to go back 10 years before that to when I first started making clay, throwing clay on the potter's wheel. I was 15 years old and it was a high school ceramic class. And it quickly became my favorite subject. And I practiced as much as I could and I got pretty good at it, I thought. I made my first dinnerware set before I graduated from high school. But more importantly, I thought of myself as a potter. I identified myself as being a potter. And people say, well, I was lucky because I knew what I wanted to do very early on in life. But trust me, nobody said that being a potter was a viable career choice. I got quite a lot of different idea about that. So halfway through college, I still was agonizing over what my career choice would be. And I remember when I finally got clarity in this subject, it was on July 4th, 1976. I remember because I was going up to Boston to see the bicentennial fireworks. And we gave a ride in our car. We met in, on the ferry boat, this high college professor. And driving up, my friend and I, and he were talking in the front seat of the car about the Red Sox. I'm in the back, agonizing about my career choice. So I asked him, and he said, "Well, it doesn't matter what you do, look back, as long as you're the best at what you do." And I'm thinking, best at what I do? No, I can't be the best at anything. I'm not the best at anything. I'm a terrible student, even when I try hard. And I'm not even the best potter I know. But what that meant to me as I thought about it was that I would give the best of myself if I continued with the clay. I could become whatever I wanted to, maybe, if I tried hard enough. So I got my BFA with an emphasis on ceramics, and I got married, and we moved to Florida, and I set up my first studio, and I made lots of pots and sold them on the weekends at art shows all around the state. But I was not good at the business end of this because I never took any business courses. In college, I just took courses in pure art. And I had to learn by struggling that how to make my art into a small business. Well, I guess I did all right because I have made thousands of pots through the years. I don't have any of them. I've sold them all. I've been really happy with my progression of work. What I'm showing you on the screen here is just a progression of how the work started, how day after day, work cycle after work cycle, it evolved into the work that I'm doing now. I started looking at the structural aspects of the pieces, and the pieces became more sculptural, and I got more air into the pieces. They started looking lighter and becoming more like what my work looks like now. And it's been a really good road. I choose this road again. I've learned so much. I have wonderful art show friends all over the country. I've seen places I never would see if I hadn't had a career as an artist. But there is one thing I have to tell you about. And that is the George Orr days, my George Orr days, that's what I call them. But we'll talk about him later. There were a lot of days when I was very frustrated with my career, my work. I just felt like a failure when I had a whole kiln load of work not come out because the kiln misfired, a month's worth of work down the drain in a couple of hours, or when I was on the road and my van broke down and I'm by the side of the road trying to get to a show, what is this? Or the time my van got stolen with all of my artwork. All kinds of rejections through the years have been a part of all of the elations of doing the work that I wanted to do. But the worst thing, I think, is when people just won't buy the work. You know, I go to a show and the work is slow selling, and people tell me all of the reasons that it couldn't possibly fit in their house, why they can't buy it, it's way too fragile. Their cats would knock it over in a minute. You wouldn't know. You could not believe how many cat stories I had. And I think about those cats. I think about all those cats. And I think, yeah, the work is too fragile. Why am I making it? What is the purpose of this work? And when that voice, when those cats get too loud, I think about my friend George Orr. George Orr, the mad potter from Biloxi, Mississippi. Now, he lived from 1857 to 1918, so I never actually met him. But he was a potter like me. and he made beautiful art pottery. And he made traditional work too, but what he was passionate about was art pottery. And he was a good showman too, and he was good at promoting himself. So you can't say that he wasn't promoting this beautiful art pottery, but people just didn't get it. Here's some more of it. I think it's so beautiful. But he couldn't get anybody else to like it. He made it, he stored it. He said, someday people are going to value this work, and he had confidence in himself on that. He didn't let anybody else's opinion of the value of his work bother him. And that, to me, was great. And the thing was, he was 60 years ahead of his time. I mean, he has now this art potteries and museums all over the country. He even has a museum built for him in Biloxi, Mississippi. But he never saw any of that. Well, to me, that's the whole point, because even if I don't see anybody else responding to my work, I can know in myself that it is good work. And I think, too, that George Orr, he gained sustenance from the doing of his work. And I gained sustenance from the doing of my work. It's in the very doing of it that I am getting the thing that carries me through, that I consider to be the most important thing in my life. So it did start out as a journey into the unknown, and I still don't know what the future work is going to be. It continues to be a journey into the unknown. It's not always comfortable, but it is always interesting, and I wish you all to have the best journey of yours.